नमस्कृत्य नरं चैव नरोत्तमम् देवीं सरस्वतीं व्यासं ततो जयमुदीरये।
ओके, वेयर वर वी लास्ट टाइम?
पांडू डेड।
पांडू इज डेड एंड हैज बीन क्रिमेटेड। माद्री हैज गॉन विद हिम to the next world. It was a poignant situation. And Kunti is there in the forest in Shatashringa mountain. All five children are with her. All the rishis and tapasvis are standing there in the forest. That is the situation. The tapasvis and the rishis who are there, they think about the situation and what should be done now. So they decide that the right thing to do as per dharma would be to take Kunti and Pandavas back to their country, to their native place. Alone in the forest is not the right thing for them to stay now. They should go back to their native place. So they decide to go to Hastinapura and formally hand over Kunti and the children to Bhishma and other elders of Hastinapura. So taking Kunti and the Pandavas and the Asti, you know what is Asti? The bones, the remains of the cremation of Pandu and Madri both. They start for Hastinapura. Now Kunti, you must understand, she was a queen. She was a princess and a queen. Having been a princess and a queen, after that she has been in Vanaprastha Ashram for many years. She has been living a forest life and that too controlling, having no luxury at all. Now she is going back to Hastinapura. But Vyasa says, although she has been deprived of all comforts for a long time, she does not feel any joy in going back to Hastinapura. She is only doing it because she has to do it. So she is going back with the rishis and the children. And they reach the gateway of the town. Hastinapur is near Delhi. You know, Delhi is Indraprastha, Hastinapur, all that is Delhi. Kurukshetra is short distance from Delhi in Haryana. All these are real places. You can go and see those places if you are in North India, where Bhishma died, where Bhagavad Gita was chanted. All those are real, real places which are till now maintained. So they reach the gateway of the city and the rishis then, how many rishis? Hundreds and hundreds of them have come from the forest accompanying Kunti and the Pandavas. Some thousands of rishis have come from the Himalayan hills, bringing them to hand them over to Bhishma. And they come and they halt outside and send word to the king that the rishis from the Himalayas have come. Word is sent. In a second, the gatekeeper goes and notifies the king. God, there's some thousand rishis have come outside. They're waiting. In Rajadharma, in the duties of a king, very beautifully it is brought out and actually in Ramayanam also, one thing the kings don't want to do is to make people wait. A good king does not make people wait. In fact, he is scared of making rishis, etc. wait, because you may curse and go away. Then it's a problem. Huge problem. Especially if some elders, some mendicants, some people who have some need, some desire, or rishis or tapasvis come. He may be hungry. 4 days he's not had food. He comes, please tell, I have come. He says, no, wait half an hour, after this meeting I'll come. Means he may curse and go away. The entire land may become bereft of food after that. It's a big problem. So immediately these gatekeepers know all that, whom to announce, whom not to announce, all that they know very well. So when they see so many rishis have come, they immediately within a second they go running inside, tell the king, God knows, looks like the entire rishis of Himalaya seems to have come. All the people of the city also immediately, like rumors, like wildfire, everybody, all the citizens of Hastinapur come to know that heavy tapasvis, all jata and all that stuff, have come from Himalayas and they are camping outside the city. in about 2 hours, in less than in our things, muhurtam, in a muhurtam's time, 2 hours time, entire inhabitants of Hastinapura, including women and children, they all come out to see the rishis and have their darshan. They all leave their homes, stop everything as it is, and they are coming outside. And little bit time, Bhishma, etc. are taking to arrange so that they can do proper welcome. So Bhishma, Dhritarashtra, Sanjaya, Vidura, etc. They also come rushing outside. So also does Satyavati. And what are the daughters-in-law's names?
Three Kashi Raja's daughters.
Amba is not here now. Ambika and Ambalika.
All these people. They also called, anyway. Gandhari. You know who's Gandhari?
Dhritarashtra. Good. Fair enough. Gandhari, all of them come rushing to outside the city to stay for the darshan of the rishis. Duryodhana and all the brothers. They also come rushing. Rishis have come. Everyone comes and bows to the rishis. They do namaskaram to the rishis and sit down peacefully. And then they are there. The rishis have them. They have kept them somewhere. Then the Kauravas bring their purohitas and then meet. You know, proper procedure is adopted to welcome them. Everybody sits down. Bhishma formally welcomes them with Argyam, Padyam, Purna Kumbham and all that. They normally say, like, you know, they must have read in this, the city, they present the key of the city. And when a major person comes, like if the Queen of Elizabeth comes to Madras, sometimes there will be a ceremony, mayor will present the key of the city. And there's a concept of the key of the city. In the sense that it is yours. This kingdom is yours. So if a rishi, it's a form of honor. She cannot open any lock with that key. That's a separate thing. It's a golden key. It will be there in her thing, or the key of Chennai, or key of Istanbul, key of Moscow, whatever. I mean, it's a queen's prerogative to have keys. So she has keys. Right. So be that as it may, they come and they'll say to the tapasvis, tell us what we can do for you. The kingdom is yours. Bhishma will say, the kingdom is yours, so they invite all of them. Right. Now they're formally welcomed and all that. Then the eldest of the Maharishis, there's so many, hundreds and hundreds, of them the eldest, after taking permission from the other Rishis, starts talking. He's having jata, he's wearing deer skin, and he says to Bhishma, "Oh Bhishma, your son Pandu the king, who had renounced pleasures of the senses, who had renounced worldly life and was living in the forest observing Vanaprastha Ashrama rules strictly. That Dharmatma who lived on fruits and roots and observed with great care along with his two wives all the rules prescribed for Vanaprastha Ashrama, and he did tapas in accordance with the Shastras, along with his two wives. By his great Uttama Acharam and Vyavaharam, by his supreme behavior and the way he did his tapas, etc., he pleased all the rishis and munis of the forest in the mountain. He maintained Nitya Brahmacharya, but by the grace of the gods, he has begotten these children.
That they already know, but
rishis are formally telling. Now this is coming from the rishis. There should be no... Why should the rishis come? Because they want to ensure there is no vignam in their taking back the family. They can refuse. They can. If a woman comes alone, they can throw her out. But if she is accompanied by a rishi, they will think twice. Because follow my curse. You have to take the Dharmatma's words. It's the words of a rishi. Okay. No, Dhritarashtra was not known to they have come because they know Dhritarashtra is not a good man. They want to ensure that the right thing is done. So they have come. So they are telling all this, that he has begotten all these sons, and they say Yudhishthira, the first son, Yudhishthira formally introduced, he is Dharmaputra. This is Bhima, he is a Vayuputra. Like that. This is Arjuna, like that they introduce And they say, all of them, this is the Dhananjaya, the third son, who is an aspect of Indra. His fame will put to shame all other archers. These rishis are telling Bhishma and others, Vidura and all that. Similarly, the Ashwini twins begotten Nannakula and Sahadeva. And by being firm on Dharma, Pandu stayed in the forest. He has re-blossomed his Vamsha, which was going away. It's Vamsha Vriddhi he has done. And you will be, or when you come to see these children and see how they have learnt, what they have learnt, their skills in weapons, their learning of Vedas, etc. I am assured you will all be very pleased with what these children have accomplished so far. But living with such in such circumstances in the forest, Pandu has now died. He has gone to Paralokam. He's gone to Pitrulokam, and when he was laid in the forest in the funeral pyre and his body was offered to the Homa, at the same time Madri also gave up delusion of life, Moham. She gave up Moham and went with him. This the eldest Maharishi tells Bhishma. That Pativrata Devi also went with him to Pitruloka. Their ashes, their asti has been brought. Now, for Pandu and Madri, whatever rites you deem fit, you may do. We have brought the asti. They give hand over the asti to them. Now, this Kunti and Pandavas have come to you for protection and care. You may accept them with grace, because that would be Sanatana Dharma. The eternal rightest thing to do would be for you to accept Kunti and these children. And for Pandu and Madhuri, you may do Shraddham, Samskaram, whatever you think you may do. And also you should do Pitrumeda, one particular type of rite for Pandu, they tell. Having said all this to the Kauravas, where all the entire Kauravas in Hastinapura are camping outside with the rishis, Bhishma and Vidura and everybody is there, Sanjaya and all that, Gandhari, everybody. Thousands of rishis from the hills with Pandu and with Kunti and the children. Thousands of rishis, having said this, in a second they vanish. They disappear. They are gone in a second. In a trice, in a shanam, Vyasa says, the rishis are missing. Rengali Pramantram Dikshidhar says, if you go to see Kumbh Mela, during in Prayag, in Allahabad, when all those millions of sadhus come, and there will be particular auspicious time, suddenly out of nowhere thousands of sadhus will come for bath, and within a moment they would have gone. No, but that is different. But this is that when they come. When they go, and what happened to entire Kauru, the Hastinapur people they are Brahmichipati, they are watching. Where have they gone? They were just here a second ago. Okay? Right. And they all say, sadhu, sadhu. Oh, great, great. They are just like that. Now, a royal funeral was conducted for Pandu and Madhuri. Ashes were covered with all sorts of flowers, fragrances, umbrella, taken in a palanquin. All rites are performed. They're taken to the Ganga Tiram. Right? That's what they do, right? And that's the beauty of, if you read Bharatam and etc. And you see all the rituals, rites, etc. that they tell. To see that you can relate to it even now, and that it's being done even now, it's an amazing thing in the history and tradition of any country, anywhere in the world, that you can even understand what they are talking about 5,000, 6,000 years back, and you are doing the same thing, whether it is a samskaram for birth, a marriage, a death, a upanayanam, or whatever it is. Whatever is said is still now has been protected, preserved and brought forward, which gives some hope that it will be in the future too. Hopefully, if you people manage to do that. Because the whole concept is that there somebody was telling me the other day. I had a call from somebody who said he had been to Erode and he goes there often. There are this family or a huge joint family of Gounders that he visits every once in a while. And he says, the men folk, you can't make out. They all cell phone, all that, and business, and all Honda City, that kind of guys. Is the women folk who are totally still, that they are holding on to the traditions. They organize a Bhagavata Saptaham every year. They do this, they do that, and the women. That's why it's, you know, the thing, it's called Dharma Patni. You know, you don't call Dharma Pati. Dharma is supposed to be brought, preserved by the woman. If the woman kicks Dharma football, then it will go. Then there is no hope. You can have all the Shastri girls in the world, it will not help. It's a housewife who has to keep the traditions. That's how it is. So that's why I diverged a bit. So here, all these the funeral rites was done. And Pandus, after all, and finally it was immersed, Jalanjali was done in Ganges. See, the poignancy, I mean, it's not easy. I have seen it for my brother and others. The poignancy that you feel when the ashes of your close one is finally let in Ganga, there is nothing that can come close to it. It is a timeless feeling. It is most sanctifying. You feel complete only then, when that happens. So having done that, at this time, finally Ambalika, who is the mother of Pandu, she breaks down and weeps. She just weeps. Everybody, Bhishma, Vidura, the entire people of Hastinapura are all in grief, total grief. Initially, it's always the shock. Grief comes later. Initially, it will be the shock. Then the things that need to be done, people will be coming, people will be asking, what happened, this, that, all that will go on. It's when it all, when it's over, when it's consigned to the sea or to the river or to the Tirtha, and when everybody goes, then it hits. Then the grief is very, very throat-crunching grief comes. They're all in grief. The funeral was done. Dana was given like water. A king had passed away, and his queen had passed away as a sati. Dana was like water. They just gave dana like that. Food, jewels, land, like that they just gave. And at the end of the Shraddham, when everything was over, Vyasa came to Satyavati. Vyasa is also Satyavati's son, right? Satyavati is the queen. Mother, queen mother she is. Like Britain had this queen mother, no? Queen Elizabeth's mother who just passed away at 101 or something. She was 101. She still used to have her glass of wine and she used to go in the horse and with 100. Perfect health. Peach looking. British noble lady. It would be 100. Born on August the 4th. Now, this lady, Satyavati, Vyasa comes and says, mother, in a tone that this is important. Mother, I'm sorry to tell you, but happy days are over now. Very terrible, bhayankaram times are going to come now. Right? It will get worse day by day from now. If it is bad, it can only get worse tomorrow. And each day will be worse than the other. And he says, the days of youth of Mother Earth is over. Mother Earth can no more give me fire and all that is over. Alright, we'll meet for ice cream, let us go to Mad Planet Yum, all that done. No more Scooty and all that. Serious. Days of youth is over. Now to mother-in-law's house, she has to go. Now all sorts of dosham will be there from now on. There will only be, wherever you go, there will be deceit, untruth, maya, everything will be represented falsely. People will lie through their teeth. For the sake of nothing, they'll lie. That also, that's one category of people, even now you can find. No reason. There is no reason they'll lie if they're... Huh? I don't know, it's a compulsive liar. He'll be going, station la paata, he'll be going to Trichy. You ask him, where are you going? He says, I go to Madurai. Nothing is gained. Nothing is gained by this. But he'll say, oh, you find out. That's a good thing to find. So, right. Vyasa is telling Satyavati that things are going to get terrible. All sorts of dosham will be there. Dharma and Sadachara. Sadachara means good behavior. Dharma and Sadachara will be transgressed. Everybody will violate Dharma. Everybody will violate Sadacharam. Anyayam will be there rampant everywhere. And because of Duryodhana and the Kauravas, the earth will become devoid of Veera. Of victorious, of valorous people. Kshatriyas will perish. Therefore, now that he has got her attention, now she is listening keenly. Okay, she got her attention. He says, therefore, please resort to yoga. He tells his mother, leave this place and go to the forest. Do tapas. Become a yoga parayana. Attain liberation in this very life. Don't stay a minute more. Don't wait to see the terrible destruction of your entire dynasty. Why should you? Some people want to see. There are some people who love to get into sorrow. Yeah, why? Avoid it. It's going to happen. No, some people will see some horror movie and all means what? Why they see, you tell me. And then for nights together, they'll be screaming and, you know, getting up and all that stuff. That doesn't happen. That's okay. Then it's all right. But some people do that. Okay, like that. Anyway, so no point. Go to the forest, do tapas and all that stuff. Satyavati said, my son, that is fine. I'll do that. And went in. She quickly goes inside. She wastes no time. She catches hold of her daughter-in-law, Ambika. She is Duryodhana's mother, Dhritarashtra's mother. Ambika, because of your grandson Duryodhana's evil deeds, Anyayam, the entire Bharatavamsham will be wiped out. This is what elders are saying, this is what I understand. Including Ella, Kudumba, Toda, Shendu, Gumbaloda, Govinda, Ainji fight. Finished, they are going to get. So I have heard. If you agree, then I, along with this other girl, poor Ambalika, her son, Pandu has just been cremated. Putrashokam, she is terribly in bad shape, already in grief because son has died. If you permit us, I will take her and I and Ambalika will go off to the forest and resort to yoga. God bless you. Please give me the permission. Ambika said, certainly you were the question, but I am also coming. I also don't want to stay and watch all this. I also will come with you and all three of us will push off. So they have no problem, you can also come. So they all three go and take Bhishma's ascent, saying we three want to leave now because we want to go and do tapas and you please take care of the Kauravas.
Take care of the destruction.
Okay, this is one of the reasons why he cannot ever leave Duryodhana's side. Bhishma. His own mother, Satyavati and Ambika and Ambalika have told him, they have requested him, we are leaving these people in your care and we are going off to the forest. Now this is one great thing. They will go to forest, poor Bhishma will have to suffer because they have given him to his care. Anyway, now Vaishampayana is telling what story to whom? Mahabharatam story to Janamejaya. Vaishampayana says, anyway, these ladies go off to the forest and Vyasa says they did terrific tapasya and actually achieved liberation. Achieved liberation. Question? Okay, anyway, coming back to this, we will come to that question later. They did terrific tapasya and they got liberated. So Vyasa says, even before he commences, and Vaishampayana continues, he says, all the... Vaishampana continues and says, Pandavas underwent all the samskaras. You know what samskara is? Means all the proper methods of learning. Alright. Now samskara is compared to, for example, you have rice. Rice grows as paddy. Paddy you have to reap. You have to remove the husk. You have to clean the thing. You have to boil it, put it in water, then it becomes rice, then you can eat it. All this process is samskara. You could straight away, I want to eat from the field, means you can't eat the damn thing. Okay, people object to samskara, why all this? Why marriage? We can straight away live together, have children, big deal. Then that's like eating straight from the field. Okay, you will have to also, you know, relieve yourself in the field only. That's what will happen if you eat that damn thing. So that's the samskara is what all these traditions know. We are all giving all kick to this tradition. Why do this? Why do that? One day before the wedding reception, Upanayanam. This is what happens now. And then even better, 6 months before the marriage, the girl comes to the boy's house where they get to know, icebreaking ceremony. 6 months they stay in the family. Good families. Son is in America, they should know our family's tradition. Then all that. Anyway, so those are all standing upside down a little bit now. But otherwise, samskaram is supposed to be all those traditions. Now they don't want to go through with it. They don't have a clue as to what is Saptapadi step, seven steps, or what is seeing Arundhati. Anyway, well, this is not about weddings. I'm not going to go into that. But nowadays it's good. I saw in one wedding they're distributing small books saying Viha Sampradayam, explaining all this to all the people who came. And at least during Shashti Dubhurti, when the parents get married again, they should know. At that time you must give. This is what actually you promised each other when you actually married. It's okay, we'll forget about all these 20, 30 years. You made a mess of it, but at least now on you understand what is it you promised each other. I never promised all this, and all the girls will say. The girls normally say. Okay. Alright. Okay, right. Vaishampana is continuing. All the samskara is done as per Vedas. Pandavas are spending their time, very kids, children, playing with the Kauravas, having a great time. They have, what kind of things they play in Mahabharata, they are saying. Regular kiddly, right, which you people, we people do till date, running race. Okay. Then raising the dust. Who will raise dust the maximum? That, okay. Okay. Huh? Raising the dust, eating, all sorts of games, who will eat most, like that. And most of the, you know, and most of these games, guess who won?
Bhima.
Bhima was winning all the time. Raising the dust, he'll raise the earth away. Okay. Okay. Eating, he can eat non-stop. Running race, anything, okay. He was able to combat all the Kauravas all by himself. He used to take care of 100 of those fellows. Kabaddi not mentioned here. He was a rough fellow. I mean, it's all children, no? You see, you must understand. This Bhima, those days these boys had long hair. So it was convenient. He used to catch hold of these, you know, Kauravas by their hair and bang their heads sometimes when in play. I used to drag them here and there in the ground. And then while playing in the pool, he used to catch hold of them and dunk them underwater till they scream saying, please, and then he used to let them come out and all that. He used to create, and generally, I mean, he used to make them gasp for, when they used to climb trees, he used to go and shake the trees so badly that though bloody the guys would feel scared for their life and fall down along with all the fruits in the tree. And then, all this he was doing. Okay. They used to do wrestling, running, yoga. In all this, he used to beat them hollow. Where yoga? Who can beat Bhima? He is son of Vayu. Entire yoga is based on breath. Nobody can beat him. And running. Everything, he was Vayu again. He is faster than wind. He was very good. Now, he was by far the best. He didn't have any hatred towards the Kauravas. Duryodhana developed deadly hatred towards Bhima. Firstly, he was born on the same day. But this fellow was beating the hell out of not only Duryodhana but entire his younger brothers, making him look like a damn fool. He developed deadly jealousy and animosity towards Bhima. First we heard when Duryodhana was born, what happened?
All jackals don't bray.
Donkeys brayed all over the country, jackals all barked inauspiciously, eagles and vultures all started hooting in anger and grief. All that omen was there, na? Now, that was the first mention of Duryodhana in Mahabharata. When he was born, all these inauspicious things happened. How Vidura told that you have one choice, you can kill him and the earth will be saved. But if you don't renounce him, then your entire dynasty will be finished. How they didn't do it. That is the first mention. Second mention of Duryodhana comes now. And the Sanskrit part is, Tasya dharmadapetasya papani paripashyata moha daishwaryam lobhaccha papa mati rajayata. Now what he says about Duryodhana, the second mention of Duryodhana Mahabharata. That Duryodhana, who always keeps away from dharma. Dharma unme panmata. Nothing he'll do will be right. He always keeps away from dharma. He is all eyes with respect to papa karma. He is ever intent on seeing what all papam he can do. The fellow who is under delusion, moham, and greedy for wealth and power, he is greedy for wealth and power. His mind became sinful. He had a sinful mind. This is he was a born character. He had totally animosity towards Bhima, and see how his mind will be thinking. Next step. This is now Vyasa has introduced type of character Duryodhana is. Not a good fellow. Okay? Bad fellow. Now he is thinking, this Pandava middling Bhima, he is stronger than everyone else. Now somehow if I can deceive him and tie him up, bind him, sometime maybe when he goes to play or when he's sleeping, suppose I can do that. Then I can lift him and throw him into the river, Ganges. Be done with him. Once I have finished Bhima like this, should not be much of a problem than capturing Yudhishthira and Arjuna. Teenager. Just like all of them. Teenagers happens. It's called sibling rivalry and all that. Yeah. It happens. I mean, so many times it happens. Anyway, after that I can just imprison Yudhishthira and Arjuna. It's not a problem. Bhima is not around. Then later I'll be able to rule the entire world all by myself. This is his thought. He's thinking like this. Okay. He's a sharp man. So he was always looking for an opportunity to put this theory into practice. He did an elaborate plan. He got a lovely campsite made by the river. Okay? In a beautiful garden by the river, using cloth and wool, he built lovely tent, huge tent houses. Huge, not small. Beautiful and big. Filled with all sorts of desirable items. Tall flags flying, blazing in the top of those tents. Many rooms of different type in each tent by the banks of the Ganges, and he called this campsite resort as Udaka Kridanam, which means a water sports complex. It's a lovely place. What is that water sports complex here? Some sports.
I think SL World. SL World. Okay.
Anyway, he creates a water sports complex, Udaka Kridan. Udaka Kridana, he calls it. Alright. Huge kitchen was built separately, where expert cooks prepared all kinds of eatables and drinks. Terrific. This is because he had the entire king, royalty behind him. He could call the king's architect, the king's carpenters, the king's gardeners, cooks. King's cooks are something else. I mean, they're not like... No, our cooks and ourselves, something else. And they make all kinds of things. They, you know, this is, you know, again, this Indian heritage in cooking is amazing. We are privileged to enjoy the collective wisdom of thousands of years of cooking. When you go abroad and show the vegetarian dishes to in Europe, etc., they don't know what to. Oh, green rice, yellow rice, red rice, white rice. They freak out looking at the... Just the rice. Forget about anything else. Okay. They can't believe that food can be made without meat or without fish or eggs. No, meat is separate, fish is separate. That according to them. If you're a vegetarian means you can eat fish. Okay. So you have to say, I'm a vegetarian, I don't take fish. Also, if you would want, you can say, I don't take eggs. Then you get nothing. That's a separate story. But, okay, it's a difficult thing. Anyway, so we are sitting on the Kali. I'll keep first from Bharatam, I'll come, then you can decide. Now, they prepare, Vyasa says, these expert cooks in that kitchen, they prepare bhakshyam, bhojyam, peyam, choshyam, lehyam. What is this? What is this? Bhakshyam. Bhakshyam is, now I'll tell you, that which is eaten, if you have to eat it, it has to be bit. Pallu vachi kadichidha chaadundiyo. We cannot swallow it. That is bhakshyam. Example? Or regular food. No, all solid food. One. Bhakshyam. Bhojyam. That which is eaten without using the teeth. By using the tongue mostly, like halwa. Okay, you don't necessarily have to bite and break it. Small, major work is done by the tongue. Teeth does not have to prepare it. In fact, if you don't have toothless old 90-year-old Kolpati and Koltata also, halwa in the tongue, they can just rotate it. I have seen, forget, you are talking about murk being. No, wait. You are talking about murku being bhakshyam. I have seen an 80-odd-year-old man who had no teeth. He used to take the murku. He had a method, but he made it into bhojyam. He used to keep it in the tongue and melt it. He used to squeeze it against the top. After about a couple of hours, that murku couldn't stand it anymore. It had become small. Now, he used to, with relish, finish it off. Okay. It happened. I have seen people. So this is bhakshyam is separate, bhojyam. That which is eaten without using the teeth, example halwa. This is given in Mahabharatam, so I am using halwa. Halwa was there at that time. Halwa. Payam, of course, drinkable.
What about rice?
No, must be. Choshyam. Now this is an interesting one. Choshyam. That which is sucked. Rasamatra grahanam. Only the rasa alone is taken and the rest of the part of that item is discarded. Okay. Example, mango. That's what they do in North India. No. They prepared, they brought it, they kept it. Sorry, they might have some. They might have all such items are available. I mean, I didn't mean they prepared. All such items were coming from the kitchen. Okay, here and there. So like that. Then lehyam. Lehyam is that which is licked. Licked and eaten.
Like ice cream.
In Hindi it is called, licking is called chatna. From which the word chutney comes. No, chutney. Chutney, na? Okay. And lehyam, of course, you know what is lehyam. Okay, these are. So what are the five different types of eatables?
Bhakshyam.
Choshyam. Choshyam. Choshya. Choshyam. Choosing. Choose na Hindi la. That is sucked. Choose na Hindi. Okay. Bhakshyam, Bhojyam, Peyam, Choshyam, Lehyam, Chutney. All sorts of. They would have made lehyam also, but Bhima did not require anything to digest. He could digest. Yeah, he could digest. Okay. Now, all such items are made, and this is, we are, I think, 10 minutes more and we'll wind up. This is the true Indian heritage. If you don't want the rest of the heritage, you will not, even then you won't give this up. You may say, I don't want that, I don't want this, why do this? But when you tell me one fellow will give up Indian food, Now all these were ready. Then all these food items are ready. These people have gone to play by the river. the Kauravas and Pandavas and everything. It was a beautiful resort with lovely places to relax and, you know, swing and all that stuff, with lovely white roofs, water machines apparently. I don't know what those water machines were. They must be sending water in all these directions. Sir, they had some Jala Yantras, it seems. Okay. Which must be probably fountains and sending the, running the water, running here and there and all that stuff. Lovely place. And the court painters had been commissioned to make beautiful paintings. And that garden alive with lovely paintings made by these people. All that stuff. And natural beauty was there. Lovely lotuses were in full bloom in the river and the ponds and the lakes. And flowers were strewn all over the ground. I mean, you couldn't walk without stepping they just naturally had fallen. They had not been cut and thrown. It was just blooming time. Now, this is a king's garden. I mean, that's a king's garden, like Mughal gardens in Delhi is something else. Lodhi garden, concept of garden, Vrindavan garden for the king of Mysore. I think most of you would have been to Vrindavan gardens, right? All sorts of fountains and colored lights just taking off from nowhere. Wherever the queen walks, one fountain will start. That kind of stuff. It's amazing. It was meant to please. It's a fantastic resort. Like that, these fellows are there. All the Pandavas and Kauravas are there, enjoying themselves. Wherever they please, they're going and enjoying themselves. And in fun, Duryodhana starts it. They start feeding each other, putting food into each other's mouths and like that. Okay, isn't it? And all these ads are coming. No? Can I have some? Yeah, he's having them. Chewing gum. She'll also bite the chewing gum. He'll also bite the chewing gum. Also, mango. Something is coming nowadays. They are trying to redo that old technique. Now the girl offers. Now he bites. All that's coming as ads now. Now it's not a big deal, but you know, it's there now. So in fun, they are feeding each other, but you know, and this fellow, Papi. Now Duryodhana is never ever mentioned without an adjective. That's another beautiful thing. Duratma Duryodhana, the Papi Duryodhana, Mahapapi Duryodhana, okay. He's got an adjective that goes. This Papi Duryodhana, he has planned to kill Bhima. And he has mixed deadly Kalakuta poison. Kalakuta poison, whiff of it from far, you are dead. Whiff. Smell of venom is enough. That he's ensured one set of food separately for Bhima is reserved. And in that he has deadly, personally he has mixed it. Okay? And then he is now going. Now this Duryodhana Papi, whose heart was like as sharp as a sword. Okay? This is compared to a jnani whose heart is compared to a lotus. This Duryodhana, not a jnani. It's like a sword. But he used to speak very sweetly, it seems. As if only nectar, amrutama pesham. Inside daggers, outside sweet, nicely speaking, very nicely. Okay. One of the attributes of bad people is they will speak very nicely. If you have somebody who shouts at you, you can be sure he's not a bad man. He's a good fellow. He shouts. Okay. So always sweetly talking. Be sure he's not. A good possibility that, you know, you are being led up the garden path. There is some other plans in mind. Okay. 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 Now, like a deer, they do. That's quite clear. They are enjoying themselves. Like a dear brother and well-wisher, Duryodhana. It's like, I'm coming to Bhima like a dear brother, it seems, and a well-wisher, Hitaishini. I'm your well-wisher. Anybody comes and tells you, I'm your well-wisher, be careful. Okay. No, but be careful, that's all I'm saying. Don't think kill him. Be careful. Handle with care and put a dabbal. Okay. We are the family friend, well-wisher. Okay. Now, with different types of, he's feeding this fellow, Bhima. Hey, eat this. Bhima, the more he'll eat. Bhima's core competence is eating. This is no problem. You give him this, he'll eat that. You give him this, he'll eat that. What is the big deal? You tell him this chutney is there in one full big anda. Can you finish it? I'll finish. He'll finish that off. Okay. You want me to eat the anda also? He'll ask, if possible. That type of fellow. So this fellow is giving Kalakutam and all that stuff. Okay. And Bhima, now, he loves food so much. A little bit poison taste is there, he doesn't mind. Okay. It's okay. I mean, it's all right. Just because slightly the ice cream is warm, it's okay. It's ice cream only, no? Okay, it's like, you know, when you go to buy cold drink, especially hot day. So it's not that cold, can you try? It's slightly warm. Okay, I'll take it. You're thirsty, no? I'll take it. You take it. Hot Pepsi. Like that. So they, this Bhima doesn't mind if the Pepsi is hot, the tea is cold. I mean, so long as the damn thing goes in, it's through the tongue and through the esophagus into the stomach. That's his direction. So he's fine. Alright, so he goes on eating. No, this Duryodhana, this papi Duryodhana, he's laughing to himself inside. Outside he's saying, Bhima, I'll give you something else. You are too much and all that he's telling. And inside he's laughing. Now you are finished and all that stuff. And he thinks of himself as Kritakrityan, means person who has accomplished his goal. Krityam is what needs to be done. Kritam is done. What needs to be done has been done. Kritartham, one who has achieved the objective. He thinks of himself like that because Bhima has finished over 300% of his basic target. If X amount of poison could kill 100,000 people, he has had 3x. And he doesn't mind eating more. Except he's feeling a little bit tired. He's not feeling hungry. He's feeling a little bit tired. Okay. And after that, they all go and play in the water. Now Bhima is going and swimming also. He eaten all the damn stuff. Bhima then, Duryodhana is thinking, while swimming if he goes, good, you know. So let us all swim. So they go swimming. Oh, good, heavy fun, they swim and all that. And then they get tremendously tired and they say, why not we sleep overnight in the camp? Why not? We'll sleep. King only, you know, there's an old saying in North India, which I read in a Pakistani paper actually. Somebody asked, it seems, does the lion give birth to its cub through an egg? Or does it give birth to a cub like a mammal, regularly giving birth? The answer is supposed to be, the lion is the king of the forest. If he wants to give birth using egg, it will birth using an egg. If he wants to give birth to a mammal, who is to ask the lion? Jungle ka bacha hai, ande se dega, bacha karega, koon puchega us? He's a king. So these are kings. They want to stay overnight, they stay overnight. Who is asking Amar Sanaya, Ilya, nothing. Stay overnight. Okay, all princes, big shot. Okay, they are staying overnight. Okay, 5 minutes and we are through. They are tremendously tired. But this Bhima is not only tremendously tired, he is affected by the Visham. That poison is affecting every part of his body. Visham is poison. It leads to the word called Vishayam. Objects. Sense objects are called because they are poison. That's a separate topic, just introduced in kindergarten right now. Right, so the Visham is flowing all over his body and his body is on fire. His entire body is on fire. Okay. And he sees cool breeze in the tent. They have some method. Cool breeze in the tent, deadly tired. Patak, like a tree, he just crashes down, goes to sleep. Like a log, like a jadam. He just crashes. Unconscious, comatose, prone. Okay? Seizing the correct moment, opportune moment, Duryodhana comes and with strong vines, V-I-N-E-S, Lata in Sanskrit. Tamil and Ved. What do you call V-I-N-E-S in Tamil?
What is Lata in Tamil?
Kodi. With strong Kodis. They tie up. He ties up Bhima fully. Okay. Ties him up fully. And Bhima is like a dead body. He's like a corpse. He's sleeping. And they carry the fellow, must have taken enormous strength to carry him. They must have dragged him, I suppose. Dragged him along to a high point or bank of the Ganges. And with 1, 2, 3 heave, go, bang! They just threw him into the middle of the river. Bhima is unconscious. He's a heavy fellow. He just sinks like a rock into the water. Boom! He goes down through the water. And he lands underwater. There's a place called Nagalokam. It's a kingdom of snakes. Patak! He just goes crashing into Nagalokam. And there are some small snakes and all are sleeping at that time. He got Thang! He falls on top of them. He crushes any number of snakes that are bloody on the lying are there. They just get finished, pulped. This fellow, when he was 10 days old, he crushed a rock. When he was 10 days old and he fell down, one rock got smashed to smithereens. Now he is a big man, boy, tough guy, eaten like anything. Sung, he falls, snakes get smashed. Seeing these snakes getting smashed, other snakes say, who the bloody hell has landed? They come rushing to the rescue and all of them attack Bhima, and they sink their venomous fangs into him. All over the place, all over Bhima, they bite him and they bite him and they bite him again and again and again and again. And on being bitten by the snakes, the effect of Kalakutam poison gets nullified. You see, what is the antidote for poison?
Poison.
Okay. In the sense, where the problem's solution lies in the problem itself. The poison is the antidote to the poison. Okay. Similarly, a human being is the antidote to a human being. A man is his own antidote. A man or a woman, by nature, is designed for making a mess of her life or his life. This is the nature's design. To be born again and again and again and again and again and again, and then suffer and suffer and suffer and suffer and suffer. The antidote also lies in the same person. So that is the entire teaching of the Gita. Now this fellow has now fallen and the snakes have come and bit him all over the place. But this broad-chested Bhima, who had a body of steel, although he had been bitten all over his body by snakes, didn't even feel a pinch. No, he got up now. Now Kalakuta poison is over, he's got up, Bhima is fine, he is in Nagaloka, and at that stage we come to the end of today's story. Namaha Parvati Pataye. जानकीकान्तस्मरणम्
जय जय राम राम
गोपिका जीवनस्मरणम्
गोविंदा गोविंदा
वेट्रिवेल मुरुगनक्
हर हर ओम हरा
श्री सद्गुरु स्वामिनः
जय
श्री आंजनेय स्वामिनः
जय
थैंक यू